So now we have three extremes.
Good evening. My name is Blaine Taylor. I'm the founder and CEO of 3D Extremes LLC. 3D Extremes is a modern manufacturing company that helps individuals and organizations go from a knack and sketch idea to a real product for a fraction of the cost of time. But back in 2014, while I was a junior in high school, I had a product idea and I wanted to have a prototype made. I got online, searched around trying to find help, and I quickly discovered many problems associated with work prototyping. First of all, I saw that prototyping was a long, expensive, and confusing process. Second, the response time and quote structures from the companies I was talking to were rather mediocre. Third, if your idea was complex in any form, it was very hard to explain that idea through the only channels they offered, which tended to be phone or email. And lastly, I saw that additive manufacturing processes such as 3D printing were not being used very aggressively or efficiently in-house. So I continued to search around to try to find solutions for these problems. I wanted a company that could offer a fast and simplified process with immediate pricing options so I knew what it was going to take to get started. I also wanted more ways to be able to communicate my idea to them to make sure things were being made right. And I wanted or needed affordable in-house creation processes to make this thing happen. Long story short, I continued to search around. I found no one company that offered solutions to these very noticeable problems. So in 2015, I decided to found 3D Extremes after I fell more in love with the process rather than the product. Currently at 3D Extremes, we offer 3D modeling, 3D printing, and reverse molding and casting services. Each of these services can be found throughout our various prototyping packages that we offer, with our most popular package being our Inventor package. That Inventor package includes all of those services to allow you to create that end-use final product for you to put in front of family, friends, and investors. To better explain the prototyping packages and to take you through the customer experience, I want you to meet Ricky from Hampton Roads. So Ricky, like a lot of individuals, has a product idea and has nothing but that napkin sketch. She gets on Google, searches around, and quickly finds 3D Extremes through our AdWords campaigns using targeted keywords. Once she clicks on that link and visits our website, she will be introduced to a variety of different types of information to learn of what it takes to get started. If she has any additional questions that may be specific to her project, we do have a live chat feature on the website for immediate response. On that same website, she has four different options to be able to get her project started with us. She can give us a call, shoot us an email, schedule a video conference, or book an in-person meeting. For this example, we'll say that Ricky decides to book an in-person meeting with us and the team. Now, Ricky comes in on day one, and that's where she's going to be able to explain her project idea. The next step would be to introduce her to those packages at which she chooses our most popular, the Inventor, based on her specific project. For her project, she's actually developing a very 757 themed product, just a mermaid bottle opener, for example. The next step is to turn that 2D sketch of that product into the actual 3D model. Those files can be used for mass manufacturing down the road and also for our processes that we do in-house. Once that model has been completed and those renderings have been checked and approved, we move on to the 3D printing stage. After that product has been printed, we actually apply post-process finishing tactics to get rid of any of those variations that you see come from 3D printing. After that part has been 3D printed and cleaned up, we move on to the custom mold making process, where we would cast in final in-use materials such as urethane plastics, rubbers, and even cold casting metals. By day 30, Ricky receives everything that she needed for the development of her product, including those casting pieces and those manufacturable files for down the road. Now, most of our customers actually don't stop here with those sample pieces. They instead end up purchasing additional casts to put on Kickstarter or to get additional consumer feedback. We do have a minimum of a $1,000 order for that. So for our revenue model, well, any individual that comes to us is going to go in the trickle-down effect that you see here. So they go from the 3D modeling all the way down to the casting, and we have a gross profit margin of around 78%. On a project like Ricky's, which we see as being an average, we have $3,000 in revenue, equating to about $2,340 in gross profit. Now, we know the process that Ricky went through. We know how much she paid, and we know how much we made. And we want to see how many more Ricky's are out there. Well, in 2015 alone, for the rapid prototyping market, there was about $4 billion in annual revenue, with a 9.1% expected annual growth rate from 2017 to 2022. When it comes to market validation, it's really hard to know how many individuals out there have ideas and are willing to expose those. So we tend to look at utility patents to give us a good generic view on where innovation is really occurring in the United States. So you can see here about 156,000 utility patents were awarded in the U.S. in 2015 alone, and that trickles down to 282 in the Hampton Roads area. Now, we've created a process that not only works with individuals in Hampton Roads or in Virginia, but instead can be scaled out to the entire United States through those video chat and live chat features. Now, utility patents is not the only thing we look at, of course. Only about 50% of our actual customers have patents at all when they come to us. So when it comes to competition, we like to look at cost and capability. So to give you a quick example, Spark Engineering, located in Richmond, Virginia, quoted us at $2,200 for a job that would have cost it only $1,250 after each change. So meet the team. My name is Blake Taylor, once again. I'm a founder and CEO and in charge of sales, financials, and business development. My partner, Bryce Cahoon, is in charge of 3D modeling, design, and business development. That's what I mean. When it comes to our timeline, we founded in late 2015. In 2016, we had about $10,000 in sales when we were really testing the market. After that 2016 year ended, we stepped back for a couple months, increased our capability, and bettered the process so that we could approach the market from a better standpoint. For the past 2.5 months, we've done $27,300 in revenue after rejuvenating that process. As time goes on, we have two different options. We can continue to grow organically and hope to see $200,000 in revenue with just us two on the team, along with bringing on a part-time production assistant. If we take on investment, that will lead to the first year of $380,000 in revenue, still with that gross profit margin. But regardless of which process or method we take, we will be able to scale our system to work with the entirety of the United States. That investment opportunity would be for $170,000, and you can see a little bit of a breakdown here. So additional production workers, bettering our online process, and a variety of other things. So thank you so much. I know it was a quick run, but if you have any additional questions, I'd love to answer this for you now. Thank you.
So can you tell me what kind of competency is required to operate that equipment, and then what kind of person, if you had to hire someone, what would it cost you?
So I would say that for the 3D printing, that is one of the biggest things to learn. Molding and casting is a lot more of the planning and technical aspects. But to give you a little bit of our background in teaching individuals how to 3D print, we've been hired in the past by the United States Army to come in and train their higher officers on how to build 3D printers from scratch. So when it comes to these things, breaking down or even teaching a new hiree to be able to use the process efficiently,
is there anything proprietary here? And so what is your sustainable competitive advantage?
So one thing we've noticed that is that individuals in this industry have a lot of experience, but they're very hard in their ways. They're not adopting to new tactics to put themselves in front of customers. But what we do is important. It is with the 3D printing technologies that we bring in. We do have kind of proprietary methods of the process. But that's what we really bring to the table is we simplify the process. We eliminate the headache associated with prototyping. And we deliver something much faster than you see normally come from the market.
What piece is your most your highest cost? Is it the labor? Is it the equipment? Is it the advertising?
In regards to cost for us, it would definitely be the labor. However, the marketing and advertising follows pretty closely behind. We have found rather easy ways to market to these individuals, but that's one thing we did notice after the 2016 year is you can't find people with ideas, they have to find you. So that's one of the biggest areas that I think we've begun to really grow in strategy and become a little bit more efficient in than these other companies in the industry. But labor definitely is one of the biggest things. To give you an easy breakdown of what we see from that, for every team, or what we call a team, that would be a full-time sales, full-time engineer or modeler, and then a full-time production with an assistant. That's the team that we really want to develop. And if every team you duplicate or add on, you'll see about an extra $500,000 in revenue.
So what happens when there's a 3D printer in everybody's house?
It's actually a good thing. We've debated this back and forth between me and my partner. And what we've noticed is that the more comfortable people are with the technology, the more willing they're going to be to pay for it. And we have noticed that firsthand, especially going from the 2016 to 2017 year, which was one of the biggest years for 3D printing. So people actually like knowing what's going on behind the doors of the services. We've become more transparent.
So it'd be more services-based, then I guess the value proposition would be more about the services and helping them like figure out that sketch turning into the product.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So it's for the 3D modeling and really taking them through each process that's an And the custom molding and casting is not something that individuals tend to do at home, and that's what allows for that real in-use product for you to put on Kickstarter and actually look pretty, put in front of your investors for them to really grasp the idea in regards to aesthetics and functionality.
So you talked about, scaling. So you said that you could use your video chat function capture market. Can you talk a little bit about your sales rollout plan beyond Hampton Roads?
Yeah, so we've already begun to work with individuals from Georgia, Florida, other areas where people still have ideas. You know, who would have thought? But when it comes to scalability, we are able to centralize our production process with 3D printing, custom molding, and casting. When it comes to 3D modeling, as time goes on, we may choose to actually have a sales rep and an engineer in various popular locations get that one-on-one feel. But we've already begun to bring that to the table with the use of the video chat features through using free programs like Google's Hangout Suite and different things like that. But that's kind of, it opens the doors to the entirety of the U.S. and gives them the same process.
So I know you talked that you're looking for individuals who are at the napping stage, right? But are you marketing also a specific group of people that would drive your bottom line? Or is it just kind of, you know, there's, you know, whether that's a corporate something, you said you dealt with some things with the military, but is there a group that's gonna drive that and it's not?
So it tends to be males between the ages of 28 and 40 that we tend to see as clients. So we do target those individuals on social media and through those Google AdWords campaigns the most. And we do see a pretty good rollover on that end. So we try not to assume